this video, we will discuss about signal generators. There are many situations in which we require to generate the signal within the system itself. So the type of waveforms can be either square, staircase, triangular, rectangular, pulse, etc. So generating such a signals using op-amp circuits are called as signal generators or waveform generators. Some of the type of waveform generators which we will be discussing is triangular generator, rectangular wave generator and sinusoidal wave generator. So first we will have a look into the triangular and rectangular wave generator. For this, we will be using integrated circuit and Schmitt trigger circuit. Schmitt trigger is nothing but a comparator circuit with feedback. The Schmitt trigger always produces a square wave. You can adjust the duty cycle of this by varying the charging and discharging time of the capacitor of the integrated circuit. So first we will see what is integrator. So integrator circuit using op-amp has two elements R1 and C1. So the capacitor C1 charges through resistor R1. The output of the integrator is a triangular wave. So this triangular wave is given as input to the Schmitt trigger circuit. So if we see the integrator circuit, the non-inverting terminal is grounded, hence the inverting terminal is at the virtual ground. The current which flows to the capacitor C1 charges it, and it is given by I1 is equal to V2, because V2 is the input to the integrator. So V2 divided by R1, which is also given by minus C1 into dV1 by dt. Minus because the input to the integrator is applied to the negative terminal. So we can write V2 is equal to minus R1 C1 dV1 by dt. So this is how an integrator circuit works and you can design it. Now we'll see how we obtain a triangular as well as a rectangular wave generator. The output of an integrator is triangular if its input is a square wave, while the output of the Schmitt trigger is a square wave for any type of input. Thus, if output of the Schmitt trigger is applied to the input of the integrator and output of the integrator is applied to input of the Schmitt trigger, then the circuit will work as a triangular and rectangular wave generator. So we need to have two output terminals. One is the integrator output terminal and the second one is the Schmitt trigger output terminal. So we'll see how actually it works. So we know that the output of the Schmitt trigger can be rectangular by varying the charging and discharging time of the capacitor. So its amplitude will be either at the positive saturation level or at the negative saturation level. So either the output of the Schmitt trigger is at plus or minus V saturation. So let us assume that initially the output of the Schmitt trigger is at its positive saturation. So what happens is the current which flows through capacitor C1 is plus V saturation by R1. So that is, when the output of the Schmitt trigger is at its positive saturation, the current which flows through the capacitor C1 is plus V sat by R1. So charging positive to the left and negative to the right. So this will produce a negative going ramp. It will produce a negative going ramp at its output for the time interval T1 to T2. So at T2, when the ramp voltage, it attains a lower trigger point, LTP is lower trigger point of the Schmitt trigger, the output of the Schmitt trigger immediately switches to its negative saturation. So once the output switches to negative saturation, the current through C1 will change its direction. So it now becomes negative to the left and positive to the right. This produces positive going ramp at its output for the time interval T2 to T3. So when T3 reaches UTP, upper trigger point of the Schmitt trigger, again the output changes from negative to positive. So this cycle keeps on repeating. So the circuit acts as a free-running waveform generator, producing the triangular and rectangular output waveforms. So if we want to produce, now this is a square wave. If we want to produce a rectangular wave, we can vary the duty cycle or either we can vary the frequency. So we will see how we can obtain a duty cycle and frequency adjustment making use of this circuit with a slight modification. Frequency and duty cycle can be adjusted in the triangular and rectangular wave generator by slightly modifying the actual circuit. So here you can observe that there is a resistor R4 which is present instead of resistor R1 compared to our previous circuit, as well as you have resistor R5, R6 and R7. So this R5, R6 and R7 along with the diodes constitutes a circuit wherein we can adjust the duty cycle, whereas resistor R4 adjusts the frequency of the triangular wave generated. So we'll see how it actually adjusts the frequency. So consider resistor R4. So if this R4, so you can see that R4 is a variable resistor. So if you increase resistor R4, if the R4 resistor value is increased, then it reduces the level of the charging current. So the capacitor C1 takes more time to charge. So R4 is increased, the current I1 decreases. Say suppose we don't have this, R4 is directly connected to C1. So if an R4 is increased, I1 reduces. So I1 is reduced means the capacitor takes more time to charge. So if it is taking more time to charge, then there is an increase in the interval between T1 and T2. You can observe it in the waveform. So if the capacitor takes more time to charge, the time T1 to T2 is increased, as well as T2 to T3 is also varied. So this will increase the time period T. So overall the frequency will reduce. So T1 to T2 as well as T2 to T3, the capacitor time taken for charging as well as discharging is increased. This increases the time period and hence the frequency is reduced. Say suppose if R4 is reduced, then the current will increase. Increase means the capacitor will charge and discharge at a faster rate, so that our total time is reduced and the frequency increases. So this is how, using a variable resistor R4, we can obtain a variable frequency at the output of the circuit. So now in addition to this R4, if we have resistors R5, R6 and R7, we can adjust the duty cycle. We can see that the resistor R5 is again variable. Here it is divided, you have it as R5A and R5B. The lower part is R5B, the upper part is R5A. So we will have to adjust the time interval between T1, T2 as well as T2, T3, keeping our total time period T constant. So we know that our pulse width or the duty cycle is given by D is in terms of duty cycle in terms of pulse width by total time period T. We keep T as constant so that on varying the pulse width, our duty cycle is varied. So we'll use this concept for adjusting the duty cycle. So when Smith trigger output is at positive V saturation, that is positive V saturation, diode D1 will be forward biased and the charging current I1 flows through the capacitor C1. So the path is through R4, R5A, D1, R6, C1. When Smith trigger output is at negative saturation level, the diode D2 is forward biased and the charging current I2 flows through C1, R7, D2, R5B and R4. So we will have two cases, that is when R5A is greater than R5B and when R5A is less than R5B. First we will consider R5A greater than R5B. So we'll see what happens. If R5A is greater than R5B, then the current which is charging the capacitor C1 will reduce. That is, I1 will reduce. If I1 reduces, it takes more time to charge. So this is what you get. So R5B is less. So since R5B is less, the current I2 is more, therefore it will discharge at a faster rate. So we can see that the pulse width is very large so that we obtain a large duty cycle. If R5A is less than R5B, then when R5A is less, our I1 is more. If I1 is more, the capacitor charges at a faster rate. Since R5B is greater, now our I2 is less, so it takes more time to discharge. So here we have a smaller duty cycle. So by varying R5 as well as we including resistor R6 and R7, we can have a variable duty cycle. Now if the value of R5A and R5B are equal, then we can get a 50% duty cycle. We'll see how are we going to design this circuit. For the design, the output frequency and duty cycle must be specified. Next, we will select a minimum level of capacitor charging current which should be higher than the op-amp input bias current. So the capacitor C1 can be given by I1 delta T by delta V. This is nothing but your integrated circuit design, where I1 is I1 minimum and delta T is the pulse width maximum at lowest frequency. And delta V is equal to UTP minus LTP. This is regarding the capacitor C1. So next we'll see how to design the values of R4, R5, R6, R7, R2 and R3. R2 and R3 should be designed in the same way as you design a Schmitt trigger circuit. So for that, the current through R2 must be much more than the IB maximum. So we can take I2 dash is equal to 100 IB max, assuming the current through the Schmitt trigger is I2 dash. So R3 will be equal to UTP by I2 dash, and R2 will be equal to plus V0 set by I2 dash. Next we'll see how to find the values of R4, R5, R6 and R7. So minimum I1 requires R4 to be maximum, and entire R5 should be in series with R6, giving R5A equal to R5 and R5B equal to 0. So R4 plus R5 plus R6 is equal to plus V sat minus VF divided by I1 minimum, where VF is the forward voltage drop of diode D1. So if R4 is equal to 0, then the output frequency is maximum. So if we take the ratio of charging currents for maximum pulse width at lower frequency and maximum pulse width at higher frequency, we get IF minimum divided by IF maximum is equal to F minimum by F maximum, or we can write I1 minimum by IF maximum is equal to F minimum by F maximum. So this will give R5 plus R6 equal to plus Vsat minus Vf by IF max for R4 equal to 0. So R4 can be obtained as R5 plus R6. Then R5 plus R6 divided by R6 is equal to pulse width maximum divided by pulse width minimum. So the ratio of R5 and R6 controls the maximum and minimum value of the pulse width at any frequency, and our upper threshold point UTP is given by V naught peak to peak divided by 2. So this is how we can generate a triangular and rectangular waveform generator. So hope this concept is clear. Thank you for watching this video.